Geeta, can you tell the listeners what you described Dave as when he walked into your apartment?
Oh, I described Dave as the dog from the Itchy and Scratchy show.
That's Poochie, the rockin' dog.
Hey, wiggity wiggity.
That's pretty funny.
Well, you know, in retaliation, I'm just going to start a spinoff podcast and take y'all down.
We get a lot of shots. Everybody comes to the net. We just have to get more and more pucks to the net.
What are you saying about putting pucks on net?
Continue to put pucks on net.
Well, that's the key. We got to get the puck on net.
Pucks on net.
He's got that nick for the net. Three just throws puck on net.
It was nice to get pucks on net.
Pucks on net and driving and making a hard night on him.
Live on tape from Geeta's apartment, her palatial estate on the 23rd floor. This is Pucks on Net, a Vancouver hockey podcast. Doesn't talk about fantasy or fancy stats. It's middle of the day on a Monday, so it feels like we're doing drive time radio. This is let's go to the phone lines. This is Ryan from Abbotsford.
Turn down your radio, Ryan.
It's actually very loud.
Let's go to Geeta from. What do you describe yourself as?
I'm a yuppie.
No, but I mean, I'm from Abbotsford.
That's extremely accurate, by the way.
And Dave from North Delta.
Yeah, that's right. Not Surrey. The property value reflects it.
Is there a difference between Delta and North Delta?
Yeah, South Delta, Tawasin, Scott Road's the border.
Okay.
North Delta is a little more affluent than South Delta. South Delta's a little more spittle country, a little more farm.
Okay.
They still have video stores.
That's right, and they have their own personal like cable company.
Yes, they
like
do.
Like it's Delta Cable.
Yeah. I've played many a hockey game, let me tell you.
And Dave is a...
Sun God Arena.
Were you a fixture on Sports Wave growing up?
Oh, I've been interviewed by Steve from Sports Wave several times.
He likes the free meals at the... He somehow still has... credentials. Yeah. Somehow we're sitting outside in the rain and he's got media credentials eating a plate of prime rib the size of his head. But I digress. Thanks for joining us. Wherever you got us from, make sure you follow us on Twitter at pucks.ca or pucks.net.ca. And no PMAC this week. He's hermiting down, hunkering down. He and I were in Abbotsford this weekend.
He refuses to come out of his shell?
He had a lot of curling to cover. And if you don't, you know, nobody knows how curling works.
Did he bruise his vocal cords by yelling sweep?
Yeah, he was yelling at the game.
That's how that works.
Yeah, so he's hunkered down. Hopefully he'll be...
What tournament was it?
It was the BC Provincials, and the winner goes to the Briar.
Oh, okay.
Oh, so that's a big one.
That's pretty impressive, then.
Yeah, we had we actually had good numbers, and it was on YouTube, and then YouTube's live streaming broke, like, worldwide. Everybody got mad thinking it was our problem. It wasn't.
Oh.
And then some guy that used to be in the Olympics, he won. John Morris. So
was it the guy who won the gold medal in the Paralympics and then turned out to be a big scumbag?
Was that a thing?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
I hope not. He seemed like a nice guy.
Curling controversy. It happens sometimes. Sometimes the rock breaks the wrong way.
Oh.
It breaks bad. Well, hey, was that at often used WWE live event venue, the Abbotsford Entertainment Center, also known as the Brett Kulak Dome?
No, we weren't at the we weren't there. We were at the curling club right next to my high school.
Oh, yeah. Okay. How was that? Did you go back? Did you walk through the halls?
I wanted to, but...
Flip off some old teachers?
No.
There are some esteemed alumni.
Look at this photograph.
No, I apparently got assigned into the office, and it was the middle of the day, so...
Yeah, you look like a chomo at this age if you go in there.
I didn't want to strut around with my my army-looking jacket, you know, looking disheveled and angry.
All right, all right, all right.
When they get older, I stay the same age.
Yeah, getting rejected by high school girls when you were in high school, getting rejected by high school girls 10 years after you graduate high school. Nothing changes.
Two things we got to address before we get started. First thing is, if you haven't yet, make sure you donate to our Patreon account, patreon.com/pucksonnet. We'll give shout-outs to our this week's donors at the end of the episode because we don't want to bore you too much.
Thanks, Mom.
Yeah. Oh man. I was trying to make my mom donate to because of...
Didn't she?
She said she will, but I had to get pushed up the hill in the snow to feed that 100-year-old cat of hers all week.
When you were telling me that, I didn't quite understand. I thought when you said, you know, I needed two people to push me.
Yeah.
I thought you meant like you needed two people to encourage you to go feed this cat.
You can do it, Ryan. It's just a mix of wet and dry food twice a day, bud.
I'm just sitting on the couch like, No, Michael and this very, very helpful passerby was like, he sounded a little British-y, but not really. But when it snows, people are so helpful. Like I helped somebody push a bit, but I'm sitting there just spinning tires, and that's not my car, so I don't give a shit. And then this gentleman's walking his dog. He's like, looks like you're going to need a push. I'll be right over. And then Michael came by and pushed us out. And he's a burly man. So we got in. So Patreon. And I feel like Metallica on the Black Album now because we've sold out. And we have a sponsor on the show.
Oh.
Yeah. So Dave.
Yeah.
I know you're... When's the last time you got your eyes tested?
Not that long ago. I went and saw the great people down at... our sponsor, which you didn't put on the rundown. You didn't put their name.
It's image optometry.
That's really helpful, you know, not having
I should have done that. Yeah. Well, no, I mean, actually, you don't need to get your eyes tested because you have 20/40 vision.
I have 20/15 vision.
Oh, but if you did...
You're in crisp 8K, bud. If I did, with all the options out there, why is it that so many people, including local sports pros, trust their eyes to image optometry?
Well, that's good because I don't trust a lot of people anymore. I mean, like, I don't trust the mailman. I don't trust the president.
The paper boy or even the TV?
No, I don't trust any of that.
It's all fake news.
Yeah.
Well, it could be the online prices with bricks and mortar service.
Well, I hate buying stuff on the internet. That's bullshit, too. You can't buy shoes on the internet, and you never know what fits.
I like to look the guy in my sharp eagle eyes.
I like to try my glasses on, though.
Well, yeah, some of us don't have perfectly shaped faces and heads like Poochie the dog over there.
Could it also be the direct billing that why we would go to image optometry?
I think so. I like directly being charged. You know, that's good for us. Some of us got to, you know, take money out for benefits.
It could be that they're also the only ones to offer a doctor's eye exam and a complete set of glasses for just $89.95.
No! That's bullshit.
That's way under $90. It's totally different.
You can break a hundo, a C-note.
An unbeatable deal that'll ensure you catch your next match in glorious HD.
Well, they better.
You'll see how old Roger Federer really is. It's horrible. Or Don Cherry in his horrible caked on makeup.
I'm so glad we don't get Hockey Night in Canada in 4K.
Image optometry showed me what Don Cherry really is in his final form, and I didn't like it. I mean, like, what else would you expect from the most affordable eye care chain in BC?
Oh, hell yeah. They are the best. Best in the business.
Yeah, apparently that's where Eric Goodbranson goes to see the upward pass out the middle. Image Optometry, the official eye doctors of the Canucks.
And Pucks on Net.
Online at image.ca. Imagine more.
Wait.
Or image.com.
Oh. Imagine more for less. Just like Jake Virtanen's plus minus in Utica.
And he's from Abbotsford, and I'm from Abbotsford. And if you want to see our main man, Dr. Brad, Dr. B-Rad, he's out of the one in Sevenoaks. So go check him out. Tell him Pucks on Net sent you. Actually, it's very crucial that you tell him Pucks on Net sent you.
He also told us to remember to put the club on the steering wheels of our cars because it is Abbotsford.
Oh, yeah, that mall. I mean, I used to work in that mall. They're gonna steal something off your car.
I could go get my eyes checked at Scottsdale Center. Is that where the Krispy Kreme is?
I think it is.
Oh, my old stomping grounds.
I
used to roll shopping carts downhill over there when I was 14.
Dave, it's flat.
Oh, no, there's a hill.
Like 72nd?
Ask Dave Hoskin. There's a hill. We put him in that shopping cart.
I guess we could talk about the Canucks.
I kind of wanted to start with Bill Dotrieve, the bulldozer.
Well, I mean, they took the Boston Bruins. They have a reputation. They took Don Cherry out of high school hockey and the AHL, the Rochester Americans. They took a guy, a failed, barely out of high school army barber out of Texas, and they turned him into a Stanley Cup winning, Jack Adams winning coach for the NHL, for the Boston Bruins.
Okay.
Bill Dotrieve.
This firing of Claude Julien doesn't sit right with me, actually. I don't think that it's... The issues the Bruins are having is that they're getting old.
They're getting old and they're not that good because of their questionable drafting of the last few years.
Yes. And Zdeno Chara, you know, Father Time has caught up with Big Z.
Right.
You know, they got David Bekes, I think, after his prime.
Yeah.
The Brian Sutherby trade didn't help matters much.
They've got that David Pasternak guy.
Pasternak.
His name is so boring. David Pasternak, he sounds like somebody that should play for St. Louis. He could score 50 and 38, and nobody would care because his name's David Pasternak.
You expect me to go sit by myself over there like David f***ing Pasternak? No, it doesn't sit right with me. You know, I think he's one of the elite coaches in the league. He's kept them super competitive for a long time. I think they have to thank him in some regard for the development of Patrice Bergeron and Brad Marchand.
Oh, absolutely. I mean,
and David Krejci. Yeah. I think he raised that core up So, you know, I understand they're 5 games over .500 in the Eastern Conference is super competitive this
year.
But
what does that mean? Yeah, so it means nothing.
I don't think it makes them better, like, in the long term. Like, sure, they've won a couple games with the jabron that they have doing the interim.
Bruce Cassidy? Yeah. Do you know who that is?
That name sounds so familiar.
Wasn't he a big teen heartthrob in the 70s? Oh, that was David Cassidy.
No, his nickname is Butch, and he is a fictional character.
Butch Bruce Cassidy and the Sundance Kid?
The Sundance Bergeron?
Is they got Burt Reynolds on the bench, too, there, but I just... Yeah, firing a coach midseason, I'm not a big fan of it, especially when you're in the playoffs.
It screams kind of Florida Panthers.
Yeah, you don't want to be them.
Well, I know that Don Sweeney, the GM, like, he's done some things that he didn't let the old regime, he didn't like that the old regime did.
Okay.
He didn't like Milan Lucic, like, he didn't want to re-sign him, and that's why they let him, they traded him.
He's putting up, like, back-to-back pretty solid seasons, proving that he had plenty left in the tank.
Absolutely. Well, when you're playing with Connor McDavid.
In L.A. last year, he had 55 points.
But he's not even 30.
Yeah.
And he didn't like Loui Eriksson, so he was right. He was, you know, not too... He's pretty smart about that.
Right.
But I think that maybe he thinks Claude Julien represents that old school kind of model that, you know, is kind of getting that stink on it.
I think it's a two-horse race for Las Vegas next year between Claude Julien and Gerard Gallant. I think it's going to be one of those two guys.
What about Jack Capuano?
Ugh. He needs to get out of the 1980s with that hair.
He needs to go to Image Optical so he can see how bad his haircut looks.
Yeah, in full HD. What the fuck?
Image optometry.
It wasn't his fault that his vision was obstructed.
Image optometry. I got to say that.
I remember Jack Capuano was a player with the Canucks in the early 90s, and I didn't like him then, and I don't like him now.
You don't like him now with that dead possum on his head?
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Claude Julien, you know, they beat the Canucks for the Stanley Cup in 2011. But that being said, you got to give him some credibility. 393 wins. He's the winningest Bruins head coach of all time.
That's pretty impressive.
Yeah. I think Don Cherry only has about 260, 270. He won the Jack Adams in 2008-09, right before they really started to take off. And they've won 3 straight. They shut out the Habs 4-0, which, oddly enough, is Tuukka Rask's first ever home game win against the Canadiens.
Really?
I found that fascinating.
That's very, very surprising.
Yeah, well, I mean, Tuukka time, he likes to, you know, he doesn't win a lot.
No. Well, he's been pretty good with the shutouts this year. He's got a lot of shutouts.
Well, he just shut out those Montreal Canadiens who are having trouble scoring and will trade for Alex Burrows, but more on that later.
Yes. Anton Rodin is shut down for the season.
Oh, one before we go to the Canucks, though, there's been 4 head coach firings in the NHL this year,
which is a lot. It seems high.
Yeah,
really?
It's February.
It seems above the average. Mm.
So I put them in order. On November 27th, Gerard Gallant was fired.
Okay.
Now they were 11-10, and they had just beat. I can't remember They were just played Carolina. Because you know, we heard all about their shoddy cab service and trips to the airport.
Oh, yeah, that was... Oh, man, that was botched. Yeah.
I love it. You know, you understand the firing, but you don't understand... Well, it's questionable, the firing, but, like, the outrage was the
handling of,
like,
the...
come on.
Of the situation.
I wonder how much the paparazzi that got that photo made. Or, got you know, how much he earned.
Couple of
that.
Bucks.
Couple of bucks. Anyway, so, since he got fired... The Panthers are 13-10-9.
So they're treading water still. Nothing's changed.
Yeah. Now last week they were our fringe playoff team of the week. So with now that they're healthy, that stat might not be the most.
I think the New York Islanders are my fringe playoff team of the week.
Oh yeah. Well, I mean, he got Jack Capuano
for Dougie Waite. I think that's an upgrade.
Do you think that he'll stay with the Dougster?
If they make the playoffs,
Doug and the Sleds,
you got to give him a shot. Yeah, he's probably cheap too.
Yeah,
first time head coach,
long time listener.
They're getting evicted, aren't they? They're gonna play. They're gonna be like the Harlem Globetrotters. They're just gonna play all roadsies.
No, they're gonna be the
moving to L.A.
No, they're moving to moving to Hartford. They're gonna be the Hartford Islander Whalers.
I'd love that. Bring back the
that
Cooper
sounds
Alls.
So beached whale.
That's in New Zealand. That's happening in New Zealand.
Is that because of global warming?
And apparently they were being chased by sharks.
Oh,
that's a lot of whales to be chased by sharks.
Well, Brent Burns' beard is really scary.
Well, his numbers are scary. But yeah, foreshadowing for another talking point. Their record's probably the best. They're 8-2-2. I think they went 5-0. And I think we can chalk that up to just losing the room.
Yeah.
Because that's a good team on paper.
And Doug, the Islanders?
Yeah.
Yeah, they got a lot of nice pieces on that team. And Doug Waite played on that team fairly recently, and he's been behind the bench for a couple of years now.
Okay.
A younger voice. Maybe he's able to reach these younger guys. Also, like, let John Tavares play some fucking offense.
Yeah.
Capuano's been harping on him to be a two-way player. Kind of reeks of Willie and Bo at the start of the year.
Oh, absolutely.
This
this
is Johnny Tartars, the real Johnny Hockey we're talking about here.
That reminds me, like, I think I've mentioned it a couple times in the podcast.
Yeah.
But when Theo Fleury, like, on an interview he did, he talked about, when, like, he was sent down when he turned pro, he was sent down to the AHL, and he had a coach that was on him, like, on all about how you play in the offensive zone, and he just had a hard time. He's like, listen, I'm not, you got to let me play. Mm-hmm. And he's like, all right, you can play however you want when you're on that side of the red line. I don't care what you do, because you're gifted goal scorer. Just do what you do. Whatever you do on the, but you do what I say when you're on the other side of the red line. Yeah. And I thought that's great. You just have to let your offensive players play. And that's reminded me of Ken Dryden's book when Scotty Bowman talks about his players. Do whatever, you guys know how to score goals. You guys know how to play over there. Just don't give up any goals.
Yeah, this is my system. Yeah, you can teach defense. And like, there's a lot of coaches that even I've had growing up that would try to teach you offensive skill. But it is an innate ability. And some guys have it and some guys don't. You can teach people to check. You can teach people a system. You can teach them to check for days. You cannot teach guys how to finish. You just can't. It's just a thing that some people have it. Some people don't.
And Johnny, the real Johnny Hockey, has it.
Absolutely. So let Tavares be Tavares.
Hitchcock, he got fired February 1st. The Blues, another, sounds like they lost the room. Good team on paper. They're 5-1.
Mike Yao is very yelly. I'll be interested to see how long his shelf life is on a team like St. Louis.
Like what we talked about last week was the team seemed to not like being yelled at or really, you know, tough love from Hitch.
An even tougher guy now is in Mike Yao. We all saw the footage in Minnesota when he'd flip out on them in practices.
Yeah. So I don't know about that. And then Claude Julien, the Bruins, they're 3-0. That's only been about a week, but they beat one of those against the Canucks. So what do you expect?
Give it time. I don't know. I don't like that. Of all the firings, I like that one the least.
Yeah. So is he going to go? Who's going to go to Las Vegas?
If you're looking for brand recognition and like pointing to a Stanley Cup coach to a new media market that doesn't understand exactly what they're seeing all the time, for me it's Julien, because he gives you instant credibility.
Yeah, and you look at Ken Hitchcock and he's just
he's retired.
Didn't he retire?
Yeah,
visibly.
But I think Hitch is. Waddled off into the sunset.
He's got his cup. He's got his Darian Hatcher Stars cup.
He's going to ride a rascal scooter through northern Kamloops for the rest of his life. Looking for the Walmart.
You know how many wins I got in that barn?
You know how much pet food I can put on the bottom shelf of this rascal?
Oh, 4.5 pounds.
Yeah, I'm going to load her up.
On the subject of Vegas, before we go to the Canucks, I was thinking, I was at the gym earlier, and I was in the gym on the treadmill. I don't want to brag. I'm going to drop optometry.
Right, because it doesn't happen if you don't tell us weekly.
Exactly. Once a week, I was there.
If you were doing CrossFit, you'd be insufferable.
My Instagram would just be a sweat mark on the ground, or just be me pushing a sled.
I would just show up at your house and slap you open-handed and then go home immediately.
It would be his meals with him holding protein powder in a hand.
There's a big one of those things on my kitchen counter right now.
I'd only eat things out of a shaker.
The biscuit puts protein powder in pretty much everything. I'm pretty sure he puts it in his beer.
Why doesn't he just like,
I don't know,
chicken?
I rib him about this at the house pretty constantly.
He'll be listening. Errol eats the same thing every day.
If I'm ever short on kitty litter, I'm just going to use Errol's protein powder. It clumps so nicely.
I can remember the first time I saw protein powder. It was in like a Ziploc bag, and it was like kind of cream colored.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what is this? Is this heroin or something?
I want him to feel comfortable at the house while he's here. He hasn't put anything else up for decoration, and that's most definitely his. Like, no one would ever walk into the house, take a look at me, and go, oh, Dave's trying to get some gains on.
That's Dave's protein shake.
Yeah, I'm on the machinist diet, the Christian Bale losing weight machinist diet.
I was thinking about last week. We talked about Craig Button said there's only like 3 good picks in the draft,
and then it's 3 through 15 is pretty much the same.
And if you look at the standings right now, that basically means that Colorado gets one of those picks.
Colorado Avalanche.
The Colorado Avalanche from their fire sale.
Why? They're never turning it around?
No, they need to fire.
If they can't make what they've got their work now, what can they make work? They've got so many good pieces. This is still a mystery to me of what's wrong with that fucking team. Because they got Landeskog, Duchesne,
Nathan McKinnon. Tyson Barrie.
Is Sakic their problem?
Eric Johnson, Sergei Varlamov, who's a decent tender, so they tell us. K- Calvin Pickard, the better Pickard.
Yeah.
Sakic, the only way he could really do more to help this team is to skate down the wing and shoot and stay away from snowblowers. But no, it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
And they got that Rantanen kid coming up.
I think it has some. Is Patrick Waugh to blame?
Well, I think certainly him bailing doesn't help.
Yeah. But he does that. He has a track record.
That's time for me to go. Anyway.
It's just all very, very strange.
So Colorado's going to get one of those picks.
Okay.
Arizona's going to get the other because they're just as terrible. And then Las Vegas gets one automatically, right, Dave?
Do they?
Yeah, I think they do, actually. I think they get at least a top five pick.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, I mean, it's just, you know what? It's a questionable draft. The picks are almost already spoken for. It's just...
The Canucks might as well try to see what they can do. And I think, were they 4 points out as of today?
4 points, because they keep winning games and they keep losing games.
Right.
And it's a very up and down.
They're doing their thing.
It's a really shitty roller coaster, like in the mall parking lots that come to town. Kind of goes up and down and up.
Stetcher makes a terrible giveaway. Stetcher makes an impossibly good pass.
Yeah. So there's a solid chance they're picking seventh.
Yeah.
Now that we don't work in the dub anymore consistently, at least I don't.
Mm.
I don't know what the hell is going on down there. Nolan Patrick and Nico Hersher, and then you could make up a name, I believe you.
This is a
Canucks got to pick Bob Cratchit. You got to get Bob. He's from Burnaby. He's cost effective. Kind of a bully.
Well, here's the time that you would want, like. In the when they drafted Jake Virtanen, which is just, you know, oh geez, they basically drafted the best player available.
Right.
Last year they drafted Olli Juolevi, I don't know if it was the best player available. It was the best defenseman in the draft. But you got to trust Jim Benning's judgment.
I think that's a solid pick.
Yeah, I do too. But when it happened, you're like, okay.
The Virtanen one stinks.
You know, yeah. It stinks like a lot of
things. Dylan Larkin.
And
Ehlers. Oh, sorry, guys. So I'm not really feeling that well today.
So this year,
Mom listens.
So this year, like, as some, you know, if you trust Jim Benning as a scout, now is a great year to say, really, okay, there's no real unsure standouts. The ranking could be questionable. Let's hope that he knows what he's doing and he finds the best possible suitor. But he didn't find a good suitor in Anton Rodin.
Well, that was a freebie, though. I give Benning a pass on that one because there was no money down.
Yeah.
No, do not pay until 2019. Uh-huh. it was like that free big screen TV you pick up at the Brick. You didn't need it, but it didn't cost you much extra.
What deal did Anton Rodin, a.k.a. free big screen TV, come with? Eric Goodbranson, Loui Eriksson.
Yeah.
Oh.
They put all the big money down for the sectional sofa with the recliners.
The big Loui item.
The big dumb thing. Like, why did I spend all this money on this?
It weighs a million pounds.
Yeah, it weighs a million.
I'm going to break all my friends' backs moving this thing into my new place.
Yeah, it took six guys to move them in from the Brick.
And then it doesn't even fit in your living room.
Yeah, and what am I going to do with this? It's only sit in the basement.
And then Anton Rodin was the Dynex 50-inch TV.
He's like, well, at least we got the TV, we can watch it, but the couch is too big and it doesn't work.
So, yeah, you know.
Louis's a big sectional couch. You know, like those big ugly ones that are like pleather with like cup holders and like half of the seats recline.
Yeah, it's like what a 33-year-old guy who's not married would buy. Yeah.
Good for the man cave.
Yeah.
That's Loui Eriksson.
If I spill on it, I just get a paper towel and wipe it up.
So, yeah. And Loui. That is a good description, Loui Eriksson.
Anton Rodin, like, did they mismanage his knee situation? Who's to say?
Nobody knows.
Who's to say? Like,
I don't think they did because they barely played him because they were so concerned about how injured he was.
That's really, I feel bad for him because he's having such a great year last year. He gets his shot. Like, it's really the whole situation all around is too bad. I would even say if he wanted to come back for half of what we paid him this year, if you want to do this again, one-way deal, $750,000.
I don't think he was making over $1 million.
It was 1.5, pretty sure.
Oh, okay. I'm thinking.
You want to do that again? You want to go again? Sure. Let's go again.
Give him a shot where you know he's 100% and can do a whole camp.
But I would try this again. I would. From what I saw in the preseason, it's worth another shot. He deserves a real chance.
Well, plus all these, I mean, like myself.
Did he come here broken?
Yes.
Emotionally and physically, yes. because he was drafted by the Canucks and they didn't sign him. He went and won us over by saying...
Sounds like you should be on podcast.
They did sign him. They played him in the Chicago Wolves in suburban Chicago where everybody gets murdered.
They signed him?
He played 2 years in the AHL when the Canucks were the... when they had the American hockey affiliate in Chicago, which made no fucking sense.
Hey, they
we're going to put you guys in enemy territory. Well, the Wolves... And that was hard because the Wolves also, their owner... didn't play ball with the Canucks and was signing players and was instructing the coaching staff to try to win as many games as possible. So the emphasis was on winning and not development. Well, in Utica, the Canucks have real partners, and
that's right.
The emphasis is on development rather than winning.
Okay.
And with that emphasis, they went to the Calder Cup.
Yeah, it was win-win. It worked out for everybody, and it's win-win.
No, again. It was win-lose. They lost.
Well, but they had a nice run. Nobody rioted in Utica. The monorail is still intact. It's all good.
I'm excited for Anton Rodin to come back because, you know, myself included. Yeah. There's a lot of people that have Ryan Kessler jerseys in the cupboard,
right?
In the closet,
yeah. Rodin.
And if we can, you know, just get the stitch remover out and put a Rodin on top of there, we're all sitting pretty.
Hmm. How about Brendan Gaunce? Back, speaking of Utica.
He's got 2 goals playing in Utica.
This chaps me that he got sent down. That's wrong.
2 goals in how many games?
He did not.
2.
He's on fire.
Yes.
It doesn't sit well with me that he got demoted. He was not the one who should have been demoted.
Who was on your demote list?
Jack Lackaskilly.
Oh.
I like Megna.
Jack Lackaskilly
for me, like the 30-year-old guy. Yeah, he goes... I keep up Jason Megna. I'm still riding the Megna train.
Yeah, and Chaput.
Okay.
And Mike 2-goal Chaput.
Jack Lackaskilly is the odd man out there. Because, Brendan Gaunce didn't do anything.
But Willie loves these guys.
So well, those are Willie's guys.
Yeah.
They're going to be out there in the final 30
seconds.
They
can go play for Willie in Switzerland next year because that's where he's coaching.
Davos.
See at the Spangler, big slick.
The other good news about the Canucks is Bo Horvat had his MRI and he didn't break anything.
Oh, good. Yeah, that Excellent. Looked bad at the end of the game yesterday. Yeah. I was a little worried about him.
Everybody's heart just kind of caved.
It's the one guy they can't lose.
Yeah.
For marketing standpoint, even if we're out of the playoffs, it's like, well, we'll go see Bo Horvat toe drag somebody.
We'll go see Sven Barchi. Oh, wait, he's concussed.
How long is he out for? What's the word on Sven?
That's a concussion. That one really scared me because it reminded me like the benchmark of the worst concussions is when Sidney Crosby got hit by David Steckel. And it wasn't hard. It was like he was going one way. His head was looking the other way and Steckel hit him another way. And I remember seeing a thing that's like just the way of all the force and the movement, the brain was hit the skull in like the worst possible way. And when you watch Sven Berchi, now I'm not saying this has anything to do with Sven Berchi, but he was really turned up and going one way and going another way. And Cody McLeod was going another way.
I've watched it several times. I honestly have no idea what the league discipline committee, how they make their rulings. I think it's a spinning board of truth or a blindfold and a dartboard.
It's a dartboard. I can confirm that.
They need to be much more transparent with how they're making these decisions. It makes absolutely no sense. I'm a little fired up about this.
As you should be.
It's ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous. And it's not just the Canucks. It's almost every... They get it wrong almost every single time.
Yeah.
This is your job. This is the one job that you have.
Uh-huh.
What the fuck is wrong with you?
You look at a video from 7 different angles of somebody getting hit in the head.
And you make the opposite decision of the way that everyone else who saw the same video sees it.
It's basically like it's like hybrid icing.
Okay.
Let's blow it down when nobody's going to get injured. But the second there's a foot race and somebody's going to plow into the boards.
Why the rule exists in the first place.
Yeah, it's let's see when we get here. We don't want to take... They don't want to take any violence or any physical out of the game.
Yeah.
So they leave like, you know, they worry about it at the worst possible times. Yeah. Oh, we don't want to take this hit out of the game as he chicken wings him in the head. Oh, we don't want to take big hits in the corner as they're... You know, careening into the boards, breaking their legs. Like, it doesn't make any sense.
The logic is broken, and they need to fix it. Because, like, I watched that hit. It was an accidental on purpose hit. He knew he was there.
Yeah.
The guy's a repeat offender. He's not some stud that you're going to miss on national TV in Nashville. It's Cody f***ing McLeod.
So wait,
suspend him.
What's the deal with the Department of Player Safety? Like, is it just the wrong people are running it these days?
I actually think that it needs to be people, and I'm always like on the, I'm always harping you guys about how people who played the game actually know the game better.
Right.
You thinking that that's not the case because Chris King doesn't know what he's doing?
I think for this type of thing, it's the opposite. I think guys are too close to it.
Yeah.
I've done that hit a few times. I can't suspend a guy for something I've done 10 times.
You make
times.
A great point.
What if it's someone like Eric Lindros running it?
They'd have to turn the lights down, but
it's okay.
Brightness on the monitors have to come down quite. No, but you know that's a good point.
But Eric Lindros would have given those same hits.
It needs to be.
You need somebody to know the severity.
A doctor.
And Eric, Easy E, and some sort of doctor.
But like these guys, like Stefan Quintal or whoever is running the show, Chris King.
Aren't they goons? Were they goons in their?
I just think that it's like a cop who can't pull you over for texting and driving because they do it all the time. You know what I mean?
I know exactly what you're saying.
It's the mindset. It's the exception to the rule for me that you need to have people who are outside the game monitoring this stuff, and I think it needs to be medical professionals who study impact and can look at that, and maybe even law enforcement who can understand intent.
Yeah.
But whatever they're doing right now, and I'll stand by this. I don't care if people get mad at me or whatever.
Mm-hmm. It's not working.
It's not fucking working.
Mm-hmm. No.
And it's an embarrassment to sports.
And it's not a Canuck bias or a West Coast bias. No. It's league wide.
It's league wide. They're way too soft on crime in the NHL. It's a joke.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
On that note, Chels asks, this is on a podcast related, but what is Family Day? Because we're off in the middle of the day.
It's Christy Clark needed to get reelected, so she threw us a stat holiday in February.
We in BC,
but the rest of the country gets it.
Yeah, a week later. So we have a made-up holiday in BC where it's a stat holiday.
But I'm still working. I'm going right back.
Yeah, it was kind of at work. So that's why we're off in the middle of the day for our drive time radio.
Not everybody gets it off, though.
No,
that's
because
the other thing, like only provincial employees do.
Yeah, a lot of people don't acknowledge the religious.
Well, technically, we were
Family Day.
Technically, NBC is off today, so like we're not working.
But
wink.
But Dave's a hard worker. He's in there in the trenches.
I'm grinding in the corners. I'm dumping the puck and chasing it.
Speaking of your playability, hockey ability, quick shout out to Anders, Pucks on Net listener Anders Lau, who made a Google document of players.
And I came prepared. I got a player.
So, Anders, I hope you update this. And
I love that spreadsheet.
It's a great spreadsheet because we have a theme or we have a trend the last 2 weeks of Dave being very open and honest about hockey players that he thinks that he's better than. First week, obviously, Justin Bieber. You argued. He backtracks 5 minutes and all of a sudden he's on Hockey Night in Canada. Come on. Next week, it's Mike Ribeiro, who his better years are behind him.
Well, he's on the junk. He can't hold a stick without it shaking.
Yeah, and hopefully his sexually harassing days or assaulting days are behind him, too, because that's no good.
You should watch the sitcom The Nanny. He'll learn a thing or two from Mr. Sheffield and how to conduct himself. Oh,
Mr. Sheffield and Fran had a relationship.
Yeah, but it was consensual.
Consensual.
Can you do a Fran Drescher?
No.
Oh, Mr. Sheffield.
Ugh.
Everybody else is wearing tan. That bitch shows up wearing red.
Floozy.
So this week, do you have somebody that you want to think that you're better than?
He's an elite athlete, a multiple time Pro Bowl winner, and he decided to test the waters at the Arizona Coyotes practice this week, and he did not do well. I am a better hockey player than Arizona Cardinals wide receiver Larry Fitzgerald.
All right.
The footage speaks for itself.
What were the holes in his game?
Lack of ankle support.
Was he like
able to raise the puck? despite the fact that Shane Doan was just feeding him beauty passes cross crease.
Well, he just liked to have somebody that he could pass to.
Every time he screwed up, he just kept looking for a flag. So, you know, there's no such thing as pass interference, Larry. So I'm pretty sure I could dust Larry on the ice.
Okay, and that is a professional athlete. Has he gone to the Super Bowl?
Yes, he has. He lost to the Pittsburgh Steelers. He was he did not consent to being dominated by Ben Roethlisberger, but hey, who does?
hey, I'm talking Krusty.
Yeah.
So that's update that list. I found something fascinating this morning. Oh, were you gonna say something, Geeta?
No.
You just sat there open.
Huh? What? No, go.
there is a Eastern Conference scout at the Canucks games on their questionable Eastern Conference road trip.
Alex Burrows is looking pretty good these days.
Yes, and Alex Burrows,
his stock is rising.
And there is a certain French Canadian general manager that's got an eye for French Canadian.
Well,
muckers.
Yeah, his team has lost their identity.
But what's he worth, really? Is he worth a second round pick the way he's playing? If a team is desperate to pick him up,
he's a real character guy.
I would argue that it's not what he's worth. It's based on what Bergevin, how badly he wants him, because he trades and he acquires guys like this a lot.
Brendan Gallagher.
Andy Shaw.
We ain't getting Shaw or Gallagher. I'd be happy with a third round pick. I'd be like, that's fine.
But he loves those character, hardworking guys. He traded for Shea Weber, character, hardworking guys.
Is Burr a free agent next year?
Yes.
Then they got to trade him. And if Burr wants to come back, and I'd be open to that, he can re-sign in the summer.
And it's the perfect team for him to go to and speak in all French, barely broken English.
They could pick up failed goalie prospect Zach Fucali.
Oh, or they could have picked up former.
He's playing in the ECHL, by the way.
The podcast could pick him up. He's playing in the ECHL. That'd be good. We could use that image optometry money to acquire him.
Zach Fucali.
Yeah, he won a gold medal
and a Spengler Cup this year, but still is playing for the Brampton Beast.
He'd be playing for your beer league team.
Oh, the Black Vipers.
Hey guys,
we're 18-2-1.
You don't want to disrupt the room. No. Bring it into Fucali.
We have a great goalie. He can't catch the puck. He kind of swats it down. But he
Brian Elliott.
Yeah, Brian Elliott.
But I could see the Habs really spending a little bit more.
I could too. Like a second round pick for Burrows. No disrespect. I'm a huge Alex Burrows fan.
We all are. But
right.
A second round pick for him at this age, despite his recent productivity, is way too much. That being said, Montreal could see it happen.
And if they're willing to give it up, that's not going to be a high second round pick anyways.
I would even maybe look at packaging up Burrows with a high end pick or prospect.
A Subban?
To try to bring to try to bring a guy like Brendan Gallagher home. I might offer up a Chris Tanev and an Alex Burrows.
Why would they ship out Brendan Gallagher?
He's been getting hurt a lot. Maybe they're getting impatient.
He keeps getting in the way of Shea Weber's slap shots.
I don't know. I'm just saying, like, I've never really considered Galley tradable in Montreal, but because he's been hurt so often the last couple of years, you know, and the Canucks have...
Derek Price has been hurt a lot the last couple of years, too.
The Canucks have...
You think he's expendable?
The Habs are having trouble scoring, and they're having trouble keeping the puck out, and the Canucks have pieces that could help them with both, so maybe a much bigger trade. There's no rumors out there. I'm just throwing out a suggestion.
We're fantasy booking here. What are you
Alex
on the table?
Edler and Alex Burrows could really get Montreal into the conversation for the Eastern Conference, and I don't think they're in the conversation right now with all due respect. I think they think they are, but with Pittsburgh and other teams like that, even the Rangers in the way.
All these teams with recently fired coaches that are just playing
surging
piss
like
and vinegar.
Nothing else.
Yeah.
I think you dangle Burr and you dangle Eddie.
Oh, yeah.
And you go, hey, like, you know, maybe throw in a pick.
Maybe, I could probably throw in a Hanson.
That's a blockbuster trade.
Well, because those are like,
just giving everything away.
Apparently Montreal has unlimited cap space.
Well, like, you look like
and
all the
players did less give up.
We'll find
they
places.
All that, they
for
all that Molson money, all that beer money.
Well, like,
cold shots by a lot of players.
those 19-year-olds love cold shots. That's what's paying for Shea Weber.
It's good camping beer.
Oh yeah. But anyway, like, Mark Bergevin appears to be the guy that could really kind of shoot from the hip and go based on his gut as opposed to the smarter decisions.
If I were the Canucks, I would at least ask.
Oh yeah.
What do you want?
What do you need?
What do you need? What would I need to give you to get a local kid, unlike Jake Virtanen, who's got a fantastic work ethic, heart and soul type guy, can put the puck in the net. We don't have anybody on the Canucks who can shoot like Shea Weber can, so good there.
He won't get hurt.
Trampkin hasn't.
Is he the hometown kid we want? Shea Weber.
I'd love to have Brendan Gallagher on the team.
Gallagher is the home.
No.
He's very like Cliff Ronning in the early 90s before we got to know Cliff Ronning's personality.
Geeta's eye roll there was just like, obviously.
Duh.
Anyway, I'm throwing it out there. I want listeners to tweet at us. I want them to let us know if they think I'm super off base, because I'm just saying I'm interested.
Oh, yeah, we can see it clearly.
Yeah, there's your new number 17 there, bud.
Because God knows nobody's wearing number 11 again after that goddamn Mark Messier.
Speaking of players I've had a long-time crush on.
Brent Burns?
Oh, I love Brent Burns. And I have since he was in Minnesota. How did they let him go?
Wasn't he traded for Danny Heatley?
Yeah. that's the Minnesota Wild's equivalent of the Canucks Cam Neely trade right there. That's the same type of fleecing.
Whoops.
We got to bring some goal scoring in here.
Forget about Ron Wilson ever getting fired. He can just go Brent Burns trade, yeah. Mic drop.
See you later.
Playoff schmayoffs. I got you the bearded one.
He did they trade for Danny Heatley like right after the Olympics or something?
It was Heatley wanted out of Ottawa.
He wanted out of, no, but he was traded from San Jose.
No, when he got traded to San Jose, it was no, from...
Well, yeah, but he, I mean, did he want out of San Jose? Like, when was he traded from
no,
San Jose?
No, they just, they were like, 2010-11 was his last year there, and he, right. The numbers were fading.
Yeah, because he went to the, he went to the, they went to the West Final with the, against the Canucks, and Heater was like on was the
a,
fourth line.
It was a countdown to the end of his career. The number on the left of his goal total, 5, 4, 3, 2,
Minnesota.
1, Germany.
He can speak his native language. Yeah. Language there.
Yeah. What's the, like, you can drive on the Autobahn real fast. That works out for him every time.
Oh. Brent yeah. Burns has, Brent Burns. Okay. So, like, we all know that Connor McDavid is leading the league
right.
in points.
Called that
but...
one. I, if you go back, I called that in September. I said he'd win the Art Ross. So I'm riding
yeah,
that McDavid train.
Is he? I mean, this is really close.
He's Brent Burns, a defenseman on a bat, you know, on a West Coast team. His 2 points back. He has 59 points.
He's got a great body, terrific body.
He's got an amazing beard.
He's a good-looking guy.
He looks like a homeless man.
He's what
we
kind
of like it, though.
I'm pretty sure I saw two of Brent Burns at Matchstick Coffee on the way over here.
Yeah, I saw.
They were at the Tom Green show.
I love going there, but I had to wait 5 minutes for a drip coffee. It seems a little ceremonious.
One another.
Because they're mixing it up. It tastes like coffee. It's fine.
It's worth the wait. I mean, you're just going to pour sugar and cream in there, and that's that.
I didn't out of intimidation because they watched me put the lid on. They're like, that's from Nicaragua and it's fair trade. Like, don't, why would you put creamer in that?
It's like, why wouldn't I?
You won't be able to taste the apricot.
It's
you
like,
won't be able
it's
to.
Cool.
Do you drink black coffee?
No, I like it with cream and sugar.
Yeah, because you're a normal person. Mm.
That's how they make it for the number 5.
No, that's what the grinds.
The grounds are still in there.
Geeta likes a little texture in her coffee, and the number 5 is happy to provide.
So Brent Burns has strip club. On that strip club note, Brent Burns, because he's never wearing a shirt, he has 24 goals. 24 fucking goals. No Canuck has that many goals. Bo Horvat, I think, has 17. I think
we
he's leading.
We paid a guy to get that many.
He'll do it. He'll get it. He's
spend. Oh, Eriksson.
Yeah, that giant brick coach down in the basement.
He will get it.
You know
over
what? He might
portions of the when next the four seasons.
When the Canucks fade out in March and they're in garbage time, I could see him getting hot, getting 2-goal games and 6-3 losses.
Oh, Taylor Hall time.
Yeah, garbage time.
He's got 30. Okay, so 59 points, 57 games, so over a point a game.
Mm-hmm.
His last 10 games, he has 5 goals and 7 assists.
He'll look good in playing in Brent Burns.
Yeah.
I was like, he's got some Kevin Hatcher numbers.
Yeah, which I don't know who Kevin Hatcher is.
He's Darian's brother.
No way.
The Bash brothers.
Were they? Did they ever play on the same team together?
They did, yeah. Oh, yeah, Dallas.
Dallas.
Really?
Yeah.
Big boys.
Were they on the Stanley Cup team together?
No, just Darian.
Yeah, that's pretty interesting.
Kevin was older. He was at the end of his career when he went to Dallas. He was heyday was terrorizing the old Patrick Division on the Washington Capitals.
No,
did one of the Hatchers play in Edmonton?
No.
Oh,
pretty sure no. Maybe for a year. A lot of guys went to Edmonton to try to fix that defense in the mid 2000s.
I think Darian Hatcher went, he just played against them every year in the playoffs, and then it just kind of blends together.
Mm. Yeah, I think he finished in Detroit.
Okay.
That's right, yeah.
As one does.
Speaking of Detroit, I don't know if there's much to talk about.
They
but
stink now.
Everybody got hit in the face with a stick this weekend.
Oh, man, okay. I watched that live when Nyquist got, what's his face, on Minnesota. That was a beauty.
Jared Spurgeon, who Bruce Boudreau said, the best defenseman nobody knows about. Now, Dave, you're playing a lot more hockey than I am, and you know you're an emotional guy on the ice.
Right.
Was that an instance of him just getting mad and then just...
That was his brain took a little breaky-poo there.
There was a blip for a second.
Because you watched, they had a hard battle on the boards, which was all good. A little what I call whack, fuck.
Yeah.
Whack, fuck. You know?
Both sides were getting a little bit.
And then I watched Nyquist's brain just short circuit for just a second. I've been there. I've done it.
Oh, yeah.
I've done that to people. And it's just like, you feel horrible, but you're just like, you're upset and you're holding a weapon. That it's like, but it's like immediate guilt. You're like, oh my God, what have I done? Yeah. Oh shit.
Like he's looking down like, oh shit, as he's like not even on the ice yet. And it's just that, I think it's just that
violence.
Instant moment.
He'll get suspended
Oh, well, absolutely.
Who knows, actually?
Who knows?
Spin the wheel.
Nyquist, Selke Trophy winner.
never probably ever been even close to an offender. Cody McLeod's been an offender several times, but Nyquist still throw the book at.
Yeah.
Honestly, I'd be like, you know what you did. I'm going to give him a game. I'd give him one game for that because there's a good chance that a guy like Gustav Nyquist is going to learn his lesson and never do that again.
Well, he's smart. He has some common sense to him.
He's European.
My punishment is that he has to go down to St. Paul, Minnesota and shovel the parking lot for the Wild fans.
It's going to take him years.
Yeah. Well, you can serve as many game suspension as we give you, or you can continue
shovel the parking lot.
And don't, until you're done, you can't play hockey.
Take the suspension, kid.
Yeah. Take the one game. You know how big that XL Energy parking lot is? Oh, he'll be there for days.
Yeah. Well, it was a pretty brutal chop, but
Galchenyuk hit somebody in the face too, but hit a Bruin, but it wasn't nearly as vicious.
Is it Brad Marchand?
No, who I can't figure out each week if I like or hate. Yeah, I don't think he did anything stupid in the Canucks game, but he's
a really annoying hot girl. It's like, yeah, you would, but you wouldn't feel good about it.
Yeah. Why? Because she would break you down emotionally, or hit you in the head, or
she would slew foot you in the hallway.
But then she would say something very positive about the LGBTQ
and make
community.
Make some really nice plays.
Yeah, and
but then would like slash your mom in the stomach.
And then she'd yell, "Kiss this ring, bitch!" Yeah,
and then get a misspelled Stanley Cup champion tattoo.
And she'd be best friends with Tyler Seguin.
Seguin.
The other thing I want, I guess we're almost slowly starting to wrap up. The Capitals are pretty good, but we already knew that. Mm-hmm. Is there anything that's going to get in their way besides a second round playoff appearance? Like
Alex Edler and Alex Burrows playing for the Montreal Canadiens. All kidding aside, if Carey Price is going to get right eventually, this is a blip on the radar screen.
It's a long blip.
If I had to play anybody in the playoffs, I'd be scared of Montreal just because of Carey Price in the first round. If I was an elite team... Because the Habs are, it sounds like the Habs are going to slide into that bottom part of the top eight.
Okay.
I would be like, no.
Yeah, he gets hot, and then the Habs have that unfortunate Habs advantage where like some old guy like Guy Lafleur or Ken Dryden or somebody who actually, well, he doesn't really care.
A hot goalie can really fuck up your plans.
Yeah, but then.
And there are hot goalies in that bottom eight. Like,
wait, where were you going?
Well, like you remember how like Guy or what's his name? Who's the guy that just died? John Beliveau. You know, all of a sudden he goes down and talks to the guys before the game.
The ghost of John Beliveau?
When he was still alive. When he still had his seat.
So you're going to have Dale Hunter from the Capitals go down and elbow someone in the head needlessly?
No, we're going to have, like, that's what will happen to the Habs. Some old guy that's won 50 Stanley Cups will go down there and say, "You're playing for the people of Montreal and Quebec."
I hope it's Patrick Waugh.
And then, well, and then they'll just get...
He'll rip the door off the dressing room.
It's like a cult leader coming in. And the next thing you know, they're running through walls for him because they got to play for the gods, the ghost of Maurice Richard.
Right.
And then they upset the Capitals, and then they get swept by the Penguins in the East Final.
But if you want to know what could upset the Capitals, it's a hot goalie. If they get Luongo in the first round of the Florida Panthers, that could be bad for them. they could get Carey Price. That would be bad news. Like, that kind of thing could really screw them up. You want Buffalo to get it right. You want Buffalo to get in.
So that Robin Leonard noted. Did you see
the noted snap show? That's not the first time, by the way. He's a repeat offender.
He is. Yeah. Was he a bit of an asshole in Ottawa?
He's the only guy who ever took his goalie pad off and tried to beat somebody up. The only guy who ever did that. But he's a full sleeve tattoo, Sons of Anarchy enthusiast.
He has a neck tattoo on the back of his neck.
Yeah.
He's one of these Swedish guys who there's been no real Vikings around for 700 years, but he'll tell you that he's a Viking.
Oh yeah,
it's like shut the.
I mean, like I don't even know what Alex Burrows wasn't even in the crease and he like lost it on him. Did you see that?
Leonard's one of those guys who could be a really really good goalie in this league if he just shut the up and calm down.
Mm.
That's very nice.
Jacob Markstrom, I can't decide whether
he's good or not.
Can't, like, yeah.
Okay.
He's a two-face.
Yeah.
Looked pretty good last night.
Well, anybody looks good against the Buffalo Sabres. Your line about Buffalo being bad on the podcast last week got a lot of positivity. Nothing's good about Buffalo. You go out, you get beat up by Evander Kane.
You got a story. Come back over back into Hamilton. Guess what we did?
And you have a pending lawsuit with a nice solid settlement.
Went to Wild Wings and got punched by a hockey player with a nice high fade.
It's a good fade.
It's a pretty good fade.
It's that weekly. The Capitals set a record where they scored like 5 goals every home game for like 10 straight games or 11 straight games or something.
And they have that's the worst impressive. Goal horn in the NHL. It's so long and siren-y.
Really?
It's awful.
I don't know. I couldn't tell you what it sounds. I couldn't remember what it sounds like.
You should find it.
It's been the same forever. I don't like it.
Well, if Dave doesn't like it, then we got to play it.
No.
You guys can find like 90 seconds while I look for this.
Please don't do this. Please don't. Just watch a Capitals home game. You'll hear it like 5 times.
2017 Capitals goal horn. Let's hear what this sounds like.
Oh, yeah.
And it goes forever.
That keeps going.
You can't
that's
tell
Iron,
if...
Well, that's Iron Maiden. That's kind of cool.
You can't tell if Ovechkin scored or if a cop just shot another black kid. You can't yeah. tell. Either way, it's bad news.
I'm sorry for those that were listening on the bus or like had headphones in and just...
Pull over.
They have to know in 3 different counties that Ovechkin scored again.
We caused so many accidents, like people driving in on their listening to the podcast. Like, oh shit, there's an accident behind me. Something's
our
going
listeners on. Can't afford cars. They'd have to move out of their mom's basements.
We've got some affluent listeners. They gave us some money. We can yeah. talk about that now.
Dr. B-Rad.
Dr. B-Rad.
We're rebranding you, Brad.
Yeah.
To make you younger so the kids come in and get their eyes checked.
Listen, kids, there's nothing... You know,
I'm Poochie the Talking Dog, and I only go to this optometrist.
I think I'll wrap it up for this week's podcast because not a lot going on.
I got a lot of work to do at the office, and I want to go eat some tacos
I'm
before
hungry.
I do. Yeah.
Okay, well, I got to just say, this week on Patreon, we had a handful of new donors, so I just wanted we want to thank them. Chels, our Hawaiian fan who had sent us fantastic coffee and chocolate.
I keep telling her that the Carolina Hurricanes ain't moving there.
Come on, they got a rink.
It's too. I know they got to even out the teams in the West, but that's too far west. That's a long trip.
She donated. She pledged $15, so that
thank
means
you.
She gets a pucks and net puck.
Honolulu Hurricanes does have a nice ring to it.
Double H's. Just anybody that's donated enough or pledged enough to get a puck, I am in contacting with big puck industries out in Ontario. There's a lot of rigmarole. You know, it's just like the tobacco industry, big tobacco, big puck.
Right.
It's a lot. So I'm getting those done as soon as possible. Kevin Stratton, he's down in a noted Mariners fan out of Washington. He pledged 5 bones. So we thank you for that. He gets access to donor only content. Craig Gillies, I believe he donated $5. He's out of he's the United Kingdom, Europe area. I don't want to say.
Thanks, Craig.
I don't want to say
Brexit.
Yeah, over there. I don't want to say Scotland or Ireland or confuse them.
We
or
don't
North
really
Ireland.
Know what you guys go by these days.
I don't have it printed in front of me, so I apologize. And Drew W, he donated or he pledged $5 as well. So if you want to pledge money, you can head over to patreon.com/pucksonnet. And if you you pledge $5, you get access to donor-only content, which is coming at the end of this week. If you pledge $10, you get the content, and you get access to any live shows we have. And then that's when Dave will – it'll be they'll have synthetic ice, and then Dave will challenge you to some sort of hockey skills competition.
That would actually be really fun.
There'll be pylons.
I think that there should be like – we should get a set of road hockey goalie gear, and a listener needs to face me in a 5-shot shootout.
Let's find out if you're 3 better saves, than Dave.
3 saves they win, 3 goals I win.
Or we invite them to the Dunbar Community Center for a Thursday ball hockey and, you know, you guys go in the corner and see who comes out.
Well, that's going to be me every time. Take no prisoners at the Dunby.
$15, you pledge 15, you get the listener content, you get access to live show, and you get a Pucks on Net puck, which will be made and sent out as soon as they get them. Dave will bring those to the Beer League games. And I'm thinking...
Game used puck by Pucks on Dave.
And if you don't want to pledge, but you want a puck, I'm probably going to sell them because there will be 100 of them.
How much for a dinner date with Geeta?
I don't own her. So Geeta, how much are you going to charge for that? That awkward silence says that's not offered by Patreon. $25, you get all that and a t-shirt. $100, you get everything.
How much for a dinner date with Ryan?
The minimum is $5, so I'll make a new one for like, well, I don't know, $4.50, and I'll pay for my own food, And I will, you know, I'll be there.
For $100
going to the Moose?
For $150 for $150 you get a dinner date with me, but you're paying.
Does Mrs. Dave know about this?
No funny stuff.
So for $100 you get everything. This is not inclusive to dates with us. You get $100, you get invited to the Pucks Night Christmas party. And if you do want to sponsor the podcast, you are a company, 175 clams. And
for $200 I'll wear a blazer.
Well, here's the thing. I reached out to our friends in the pornography industry,
right,
Brazzers, to say, listen, for $175 you can sponsor the podcast. They said we're too wholesome for their brand.
One, do they know that we have the exact same audience?
Yeah, your next move after listening to this, other kids, is to go right to Brazzers.
Yeah, you're not going to go to Red Tube,
which you can see in full HD thanks to image optometry. Yeah.
What you're going to do is
every crease, every crevice.
What are you talking about, hockey or porno?
Everything that's pink is in full HD.
But they are sending us t-shirts.
Yes.
So Brazzers will send us some t-shirts. We'll post a photo.
Thanks, Brazzers.
So if you want to donate or pledge some money and help us out, put some shekels in our pockets, head over to patreon.com/pucksonnet. And if you don't want to give us any money but you want to support the show, the best way to do that is to subscribe on iTunes and rate and review on iTunes. And that's the best way. Just leave a 5-star review. Say something positive. It helps us out immensely because of that bullshit iTunes algorithm. iTunes, if you're listening, please help support the podcast. And you can download. Just put it anywhere you get podcasts from. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Instagram. And follow us on Twitter. PucksNetCR, PucksNetCa. Dave. Make sure you head on over to Image Optometry. The official eye doctors of the Canucks and Pucks.net. And they're online at image.ca or image.ca. And I think that'll wrap it up. You guys, anything you want to add?
Oh, happy Valentine's Day.
Happy Chellentine's Day to everybody out there.
If you don't got a lady at home. Yeah, I got nothing.
If you don't got a lady at home, just go and be sad. Lean Cuisine in NHL 17.
That rhymes.
There you go.